Well, good morning, or good afternoon, or good evening. Whenever you're watching this video, we want to welcome you and thank you for joining us for this time of worship together on this first Sunday of Lent, February the 21st. We're so grateful that you're choosing to spend some of your time worshiping God with us here at Brighton United Methodist Church. We want to begin with a few announcements. First of all, we want to make sure that you're remaining connected to us here at the church in all the ways that you can. And that begins by going to our website at BrightonUnitedMethodistChurch.com, where you can find all the information about all of our ministries and how you can remain connected, how you can plug in and be a participant in the ministries of our church as we reach out for the kingdom of God in this community. We also want to send you over to our Facebook page, where you can look up events of upcoming things that are on the docket. We've also got information under events about our upcoming virtual Bible studies and how you can plug into those as well. You can join us Monday through Friday at noon for the midday prayer break. And, of course, we want to make sure that you get all of the information and the inspiration that you need to get through your week with us. Now, we also have a very special service planned for you today, and so I want to give you a moment here of preparation time. We are going to remember our baptisms together, even virtually. We're going to remember our baptism later on in our service, and so now's your chance. Go and get a little glass of water and have it by your side as you watch this worship video today, and be prepared to remember your baptism when the time comes, okay? Now, as we make the transition into the atmosphere of worship, we are invited there today through Psalm 25. This is verses 1 through 10. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Do not let me be put to shame. Do not let my enemies exult over me. Do not let those who wait for you be put to shame. Let them be ashamed who are wantonly treacherous. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all day long. Be mindful of your mercy, O Lord, and of your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me for your goodness' sake, O Lord. God, good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. All the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his decrees. Friends, we enter into the season of Lent. We begin this time preparing our hearts for the passion and resurrection of our Lord and Savior. Through a repentant heart, through a penitent spirit, we come to God knowing that we have sinned, but that good and upright is the Lord, instructing sinners in the way. God will lead us if we would only humble ourselves before him. Today in worship, we're invited to humble ourselves before his mighty presence and remember our baptisms. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we come before you knowing that we have fallen short of your glory. We come before you knowing that we have not earned your love. And yet, you offer it to us freely. Your steadfast love and faithfulness overwhelm us, O God. And so we come before you today, humbling ourselves in worship, crying out to you, and we ask that your Holy Spirit would come and meet us here afresh, fall upon our hearts that they might be strangely warmed, enter into our minds that we might be truly inspired. Lord, once again, take hold of our lives and transform us to your glory this day and always in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Well, we've come to that time in our service where we invite the children and youth down front for a moment to discuss a message centered around our friend here, God's Mystery Box. We've got some new entries that have come in for God's Mystery Box, and I'm so thankful to all of you who have sent in pictures. Today, we have Linda Henson, who sent in her granddaughter, Everin Pierman's pictures. You'll see them here. She's drawn a picture of a house and mountains of a city and the outdoors with a tree. Now, how are we going to see God in our pictures from Everin today? What do you think? Are you an artist? Do you like to draw? I want to know how you can see God in these beautiful pictures. So you let me know. If you want to put it in the comments below or send me an email, I'd love to hear how you can see God in these pictures. But as I was thinking about these, Everin's grandmother, Linda, told me that she wanted to find God in these places. And so when she heard about the mystery box, she wanted to send in these pictures to us so we could talk about how we could see God in these pictures. Well, I see God in these pictures because did you know that God made us in His image? That's right. God made you and I and every other human being in His image. Just like a picture is an image of something, a tree or a mountain or a house or a city, God made us in His image. Now, the image points to something greater, right? A drawing of a house points to a house. The drawing of a mountain points to the mountain, right? Well, we as images of God, we point to God. And so whenever we make an image, whenever we draw a picture, we can imagine ourselves as the picture of God that all can see. And that's really important because when we love each other, then people can experience God's love for themselves. It's so neat to be able to share that love with each other. So the next time you draw a picture, I want you to remember that you are a picture of God for the world, and go and love somebody, okay? Now, if you would like to bring for me, you can send in any picture you want to my email address at revkershaw@gmail.com. Just look around your house, snap a picture of anything you want, and email it to me, and then tune in to these virtual worships for the Sunday when we'll look at whatever you sent in for God's Mystery Box, okay? And thank you, Everin, for your beautiful pictures. Shall we pray? Let's do it. God, we thank you so much for the love that you share with us. We ask that you help us to share your love with this world, that we would be good pictures of you. Lord, we thank you for the love you share, but especially the love you share through these beautiful children each and every day. We give you thanks and praise in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Good morning and welcome. We're glad you're here with us. Scripture readings this morning are two of them. I'll begin with the first one from the New Testament in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 18 through 22. And I am reading from the NIV version of the Bible. Verse 18. For Christ died for sins once and for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in body, but made alive by the Spirit, through whom also he went and preached to the spirits in prison, who disobeyed long ago, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah, while the ark was being built. In it, only a few people, eight in all, were saved through water, and this water symbolizes baptism that now saves you also. Not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a good conscience toward God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven is at God's right hand with his angels and authorities and the powers in submission to him. The second reading is in the New Testament in the book of Mark, chapter 1, verses 9 through 15. And this is the baptism and temptation of Jesus. So at this time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. As Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and a spirit descending upon him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my son, whom I love, and with you I am well pleased." And at once the Spirit sent him out into the desert, and he was in the desert 40 days, being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and the angels had attended him. The calling of the first disciples. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news." So ends the reading from the Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, grace be yours and peace from Jesus Christ our Lord. Some of you, as you listened to the scripture reading done so beautifully by Duane today, you might have been thinking to yourself, especially if you've been following along with our virtual services for a while now, you may have been thinking to yourself, didn't we already cover this part of Mark? Yeah, we've been sort of scratching and clawing our way verse by verse through this first chapter of Mark, and it seemed like we might be getting somewhere. We were nearing the end of chapter 1, and now we've kind of gone backwards, haven't we? Well, the truth is yes and no. We have covered this part of Mark, but as I was reading the Mark passage assigned for this first Sunday in Advent, I had the same thought, and I looked back over the passages, and I realized that back on January 10th, we read through the baptism narrative of the Gospel of Mark. We got up through verse 11, where the voice of God declares, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with you I am well pleased," and the dove, the Holy Spirit, descends, right? So we got through verse 11. And then I looked a couple of weeks later, and in January 24th, we got the beginning of Jesus' ministry and the calling of Jesus' disciples, that whole beginning of things, starting in verse 14. And so we left off in verse 11, and we began in verse 14. That leaves us two verses in between these two stories, the baptism of Jesus and the beginning of his ministry, two verses, 12 and 13. Mark reports, "And the Spirit," remember this is right after the baptism, "and the Spirit," capital S, Holy Spirit, "immediately drove him out into the wilderness. And he was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him." For those two verses, we went back and we picked up the baptism. We introduced these two new verses, and then we continued on to the beginning of his ministry, right? It leaves these two verses right here in the middle, the temptation in the wilderness. Mark's account of the temptation in the wilderness is two verses. Two verses. Now, we're used to the more elaborate versions of the temptation in the wilderness that we find in Matthew and in Luke's gospel. But Mark does not give us any of that detail. He just recounts that after the baptism and before his ministry began, Jesus is driven by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness and is tempted by Satan for 40 days. Well, guess what, friends? We just began Lent. We just began this past Wednesday, the season of Lent, 40 days of preparation for the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus, at the beginning of our 40 days of preparation, Jesus is driven into the wilderness for 40 days of temptation, preparing for his ministry. You see, between his baptism and his ministry, we find these 40 days of preparation. These 40 days of preparation. Now, that was enough to settle my curiosity at first, as I wondered why we went back and picked up these verses that we've already covered, just for these two little verses in the middle. It would be kind of odd for the lectionary to just say verses 12 and 13 of chapter 1. We're going to go back and just do two verses, right? So they surrounded it with material we'd already covered to give us context, right? Where we came from, where we're going, right in the middle, these 40 days of preparation. But then I began to look at the other readings. And I mentioned in the Ash Wednesday service, if you watched that message, that sometimes these four passages of Scripture, they are obvious how they hang together. They're obvious, the thread of connection between them. And I admitted that on Ash Wednesday, that thread might be a little harder to see. But we found it, didn't we? Well, that thread was pretty obvious as I began reading the other passages of Scripture for today. The other passages of Scripture included the psalm we read at the beginning, but the Old Testament reading comes to us from Genesis 9. I didn't have Duane read that because we're so familiar with it. Genesis 9 happens to be the story of Noah, right? Noah and the ark, and specifically the covenant that God makes with his people, with Noah and his family, and all of the animals as they come off the ark, makes it with all of creation through the rainbow that I will not, God says, I will not destroy the world by flood again. And then we connect that with 1 Peter, this passage from 1 Peter. And maybe you know where I'm going with this, but in 1 Peter, we had this reference in verse 20 of chapter 3. This reference in chapter 20, or chapter 3, verse 20, who in former times did not obey when God waited patiently in the days of Noah during the building of the ark in which a few, that is, eight persons, were saved through water. So we began with Noah and the flood. Peter is talking about the flood waters saving, and then he immediately goes into the baptism. He connects the flood waters of Noah, that the eight are saved through the flood waters in Noah's time, just as his contemporaries in the way, in the church, followers of Jesus, are saved by baptism. By baptism. And of course, we began the gospel reading with the baptism of Jesus. So you can see the thread starting to weave its way, starting to make its way to connect these passages together. And that, my friends, is where we begin. Do you remember your baptism? Now, of course, that question assumes that you are baptized. And I want to just begin this message by saying, if you have not been baptized, I hope you hear this message and think, it's time. It's time for me to receive the gift of God's grace through the waters of baptism, okay? If you haven't been baptized, I just want to plant that seed right now. But if you have, do you remember your baptism? Do you? I don't. And there's one very simple reason why I don't. I have faded pictures, evidence of my baptism, with my two older cousins present, as well as my grandparents and my parents and my aunts and my uncles, and all crowded into the chancel area at the Platteville United Methodist Church, where my father, a pastor in the Methodist Church, donned this very stole that I'm wearing today and performed my baptism when I was all of 1 month old, September of 1979. No wonder I don't remember it. No wonder I don't remember it. I was a month old. Many of you don't remember your baptism because you were so young. I remember Jack and Paul's baptism. I performed their baptisms, my sons. And I remember the many baptisms that I've had the privilege of performing over my 16 plus years in ministry. But I don't remember my own. I don't remember my own. And that's the case for so many of us, right? And even if you were older, you still might have a fading memory of it. You might have a fading memory of it. Well, I don't have any memory of mine, and yet I know that baptism is clearly important in the Christian faith. Clearly important, right? John begins his ministry. Mark here began his gospel with John's ministry of a baptism of repentance, right? So baptism was important to John's announcing the coming of Jesus. It was important for Jesus. Remember, he says, it is right that we do this, right? John objects. And Jesus says, no, this is what is to be done. And of course, at the end of the Gospels, as Jesus is preparing to be taken up into the heavens and be seated at the right hand of the Father, as we say, what is Jesus' instruction to the disciples and the great commission at the end of Matthew's Gospel? Remember, it's go baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we see in the book of Acts how the apostles took that great commission so seriously. And every time new people became believers, they were baptized and the Holy Spirit falls upon them. Baptism is clearly important. Baptism, of course, is clearly important throughout the whole history of the church. 2,000 years, baptism has been one of the sacraments of the church. And in fact, during the Protestant Reformation, it becomes one of only two sacraments preserved, communion and baptism, by the reformers. Baptism is 50% of our most sacred acts as a church in the Methodist tradition. It is our symbolic initiation into the life of the church. Baptism is a big deal. And here it was in 1 Peter, as I'm pondering this 40 days in the wilderness from Jesus, as I'm thinking about the start of Lent, and I'm staring right at it. 1 Peter talks about baptism. So, I wondered, as I began to craft this message, what about baptism? What about baptism? I can't remember it. Chances are you can't remember it. So what about baptism? It's clearly important. What about it? Well, Peter begins in our passage today in verse 18 by grounding its significance in what we might call in theological circles the prevenient grace of God. The prevenient grace of God. Look at verse 18 with me. It says, "For Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit." Okay? Now, Peter begins this passage by declaring how God reconciles us to himself through Christ. And it is through Christ's death and resurrection. It is Christ's death and resurrection that offers what we would call prevenient grace to all creation, to all humanity. You and I and every other person you have ever met, every other person who has ever lived, prevenient grace is offered. That is the grace offered by God. That is the present. That is the gift that God offers us. The amazing grace of God is that prevenient grace that is offered to all of us. And the question about prevenient grace is, will we receive that gift? Will we receive that gift? But the gift can only come because of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Peter's clear. It begins there. The crucifixion and resurrection are the prerequisite for the meaning of baptism. Okay? Without the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus, baptism is just a bath. Baptism is just a scrub down, right? As John says, "I baptize you with water, but one who is coming after me will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." It is just a baptism of water. It's just an extra bath if it were not for the prevenient grace of Jesus Christ's crucifixion and resurrection. Okay? Now, Peter goes on. Peter goes on. He says, he starts in verse 20, he's talking about the crucifixion and resurrection, and Jesus, and he says, who in former times did not obey, that would be the people, right? Who in former times, there were people who did not obey when God waited patiently in the days of Noah, right? As Noah is building the ark, in which few, that is 8 persons, remember Noah and his 3 sons and their wives, 8 persons, in which the few, 8 persons were saved through water. And baptism, now here we come, right? Here we come in verse 21, and baptism, which this prefigured, the waters of the flood prefigured, pointed toward the waters of baptism, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Just as the 8 are saved by the flood waters, you and I are saved through the baptismal waters, Peter is saying, right? Now, taking that general prerequisite of the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus, right, and applying it specifically to you and me, that's baptism. The general prerequisite being crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus, has no power without that. But that general prevenient grace applied specifically to you and to me through the waters, the saving waters of baptism. Are you getting the picture? Baptism is a big deal. Which is why if you haven't been baptized, I want you to prayerfully consider doing it. Give me a call. Send me an email. We'll make it happen. Baptism is a big deal. So big, in fact, that it has caused controversy in the church. The importance of baptism is so recognized by the church over the centuries that it has been a real source of controversy. I remember being in seminary, my very first semester of seminary, I was taking a class on worship leading. And of course, we baptize in the context of worship, don't we? And so we were talking about baptism, and before we could get to the practices of baptism and how to do it and when to do it and how to put it in the worship and all of those different pieces, the nuts and bolts, right? Before we could get to the nuts and bolts, a controversy broke out. We had to have a theological debate about baptism because you see, baptism is so big that some insist that you have to be a believer, that you have to be old enough to not just remember it, but to be able to know what you're professing in your faith and to profess it and believe it and to receive it through the waters of baptism. It is what we call a believer baptism. Okay, this is insisted upon as the only form of baptism by our friends in the Baptist tradition and later in the sort of non-denominational evangelical traditions, right? They hold fast to a believer baptism because baptism is so important. They insist that believers have to be able to believe before they can receive the waters of baptism. Now, we here in the Methodist tradition, we follow the practice of infant baptism. We do believer baptism for sure, but we also follow the practice of infant baptism. This dates back to the earliest church as well. Another reason baptism was so serious, another outgrowth of that is, if baptism is so critical, as Peter puts it, we are saved through the waters of baptism, just like Noah and his family were saved through the waters of the flood, then the sooner the better. Because if an infant, God forbid, should die before being baptized, what happens was the question. So infant baptism became almost an obsession in the early church. Infant baptism became the obsession and became the tradition. Now, both are rooted in Scripture. We have evidence of believer baptisms in Scripture. We have evidence that whole households are baptized, probably including children, maybe even infants, in the New Testament, in the book of Acts. And of course, we have the tradition from which our Christian tradition comes, the Jewish tradition of circumcising their boys at 8 days old, long before they could profess faith. So there's this connection with infant. It's so important, we got to do it as soon as possible. So it's so important, we have to do it only when people believe it and understand it. And we also have, it's so important that it has to be done as soon as possible after birth. Now, as big a deal, that That's interesting, isn't it? Now, as big a deal as baptism is, I'm making a huge case here for the importance of baptism, but as big a deal as baptism really is, it might surprise you to learn that Methodists do not re-baptize. We don't. We don't re-baptize. If you've already been baptized and you're starting to feel like maybe you'd like to do it again, we don't do that in the Methodist Church. We don't re-baptize. For one very important reason, if you were baptized in another Christian tradition, we recognize that baptism. We recognize that baptism in the Methodist Church. If you were baptized as an infant, we recognize that baptism as an adult. Even if you strayed far from the church and came back, we recognize your baptism. Why? Because in the waters of baptism, God is not ineffective. God is not ineffective. Whether you remember it or not, whether you strayed long and hard from your baptism and came back, God's baptism, the waters of baptism, the presence of the Holy Spirit in that moment was not ineffective. To re-baptize would be to declare God ineffective in the past. So we do not re-baptize in the Methodist Church, but we do. We do something called remembering our baptism, and we're going to do that later on in our service today. So baptism is important. Do you believe me yet? Baptism is important. Now to drill down on why it's important, we return to Peter. We return to Peter, and in verse 21, we remember that Peter outlines that baptism is prefigured by the flood waters and saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, right? This isn't an external washing. This isn't an outside thing. This is an internal thing. This is an in the heart thing, right? This is an appeal, it says, but as an appeal to God. We are saved as an appeal to God for a good conscience. An appeal to God for a good conscience. Now, you might be asking yourself, isn't conscience just that little voice in my head from God telling me what's good and what's bad? Whenever I think of the conscience, I always think of those cartoons, Tom and Jerry, right? Some other times, other cartoons where the angel would pop up on one shoulder and the devil on the other, right? The devil is trying to tempt the character. The angel is attempting to appeal to their better nature, right? Conscience is trying to win out over the temptation. The good is trying to overcome the evil, right? You just picture that almost, right? Aren't we born with that, you might be thinking? Aren't we born with our conscience? Isn't that how people who don't even believe in God can know right from wrong? Isn't that how you and I have been designed as created in the image of God? Why would we need to appeal to God for a conscience if we were born with it, if we were imprinted with it at birth? Well, the answer is we were created in God's image, imprinted with a conscience, the ability to know, a divine ability to know right from wrong. But that conscience has been corrupted by sin. A conscience has been corrupted by sin. And here's the thing. When we sin, when we do something that we know is wrong, but we do it anyway, when we follow that devil on our shoulder into temptation, and we do what we know is wrong, then we feel bad sometimes, right? We feel bad. But when we continue to do that same wrong thing, we can become numb to its badness. We can become numb to the wrong, to the point that we can even begin to be seduced into explaining how the wrong is actually not wrong. Our conscience has been corrupted by sin in this world, not just our sin, but by the sins of the world, as we position ourselves in a culture that wants to glorify the excesses and the sins of the world. We must guard our hearts against that. We must come through the waters of baptism and appeal to God for a restoration of his image, for a restoration of our conscience, for what Peter calls a good conscience, right? We appeal to God for a good conscience. What is good? Good, there, the Greek word is the most general word possible for good in the Greek, but it refers to a goodness that is grounded in the very nature of God. Right? We cry out, we appeal to God for a good conscience. We might think of it instead as a God conscience. To know what God has declared right and wrong. We appeal to God for a good conscience, a restoration of our divine image, a recalibration, a washing of our conscience corrupted by sin, replaced with a good conscience. So baptism is important. It's important for our appealing to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Paul makes that clear, or Peter makes that clear. Now, I have a question for you. Does that sound like something that only happens once? Does that sound like something that only happens once? Baptism is important for appealing to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Does that sound like something that only happens once? Well, I would suggest that it isn't. Just as you are saved by grace through faith, there is that moment, right? We call it the rebirth, right? When were you born again? When did you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? When did you turn from your sin and embrace the new life that God offers you in prevenient grace? When you have that moment, maybe you can remember it. Maybe you were too young and you don't remember it. It's just always been a part of you. Maybe you remember that moment. Just as that moment is a moment, the effects need to be continually renewed moment by moment, hour by hour, day by day, season by season. Baptism is the same. Baptism might be a moment in time. It might be a moment you don't even remember because you were too young. It might be a moment that was just a few seconds in your life, or someone poured water over your head, or immersed you in a pool, or sprinkled you with that sweet Holy Spirit water. But its effects must be continually renewed, continually appealed to God, renewing our conscience forever, forever renewing it. The power of baptism to impart God's conscience through the resurrection by the power of the Holy Spirit is a moment by moment, day by day, season by season renewal. It is not just one moment. It is a moment that lasts a lifetime. And you know who knows this? You know who knows this almost better than we do? It might surprise you. Satan. That's right. That's right, our buddy Satan. Our buddy Satan. Not our buddy Satan, right? That old tempter knows that baptism needs to be remembered, that salvation needs to be continually renewed in us. And that's why immediately after the baptism of Jesus, who shows up? Who shows up to tempt? But Satan. Immediately after the baptism of Jesus, immediately after the heavens are torn open and the Holy Spirit in the form of a dove descends and the voice of God declares, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with you I am well pleased." As soon as that is declared over Jesus, he is driven out into the wilderness by the Holy Spirit, and who shows up but the devil to tempt him? Satan knows that you must be continually renewed, and so he is going to do everything he can to disrupt that. So here's the thing, whenever you have a renewal of your spirit, don't be surprised when the devil shows up. Don't be surprised when temptation is around every corner. Don't be surprised when things might get hard for a while, because the devil knows all too well that if he can distract you from that moment and keep you from renewing yourself continually, that he can steer you away from God once again. You see, when we emerge from the cocoon of the church, newly imparted with the good conscience through the waters of baptism to face the temptations of life, That is when we come to realize that while baptism is but one moment in one day of a lifetime, the power of baptism never ceases. The power of God moving through you by the Holy Spirit never ceases. When we feel the crushing weight of this world, when we feel the luring temptations of the enemy of our souls, we must remember our baptism and be freed. Amen. Are you ready for your homework? I hope you are. I hope you are ready for your homework. Your homework is about applying what we've talked about in our message here today to our everyday lives. We're not about the theoretical here. We're about the practical. And we want to practically implement what we've been talking about. So, to that end, we begin with the Thirsty 30. Remember, that's 10 minutes of Bible reading, 10 minutes of prayer, 10 minutes of worship, 30 minutes to God each and every day. If you've been doing none of that, I want you to pick one this week. Just one. Pick one, 10 minutes to God each and every day. Now, if you've been doing some of it, but you've struggled to get to 30, maybe you've got there a few times, but consistency's been an issue, I want to encourage you, make a plan. You never get anywhere without a plan. Make a plan, dedicate yourselves this week, 30 minutes to God each and every day. Now, if you've been diligently giving God that 30 minutes each and every day, I want to challenge you to give a little bit more. Give a little bit more. You will never regret giving more of your day to the God who gives us every day. Okay? It's part of that renewal. The Thirsty 30 is part of that renewal process that I'm talking about. It's part of that continually remembering the power of our baptism, the importance of our being saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. Now, to that end, I've got a little bit of an assignment for you. During that Thirsty 30, a little bit later on in our service, we are going to remember our baptisms together. We're going to remember our baptisms together. I mentioned in the message that if you haven't been baptized, I hope you understand now how awesome and powerful that can be. And I want to encourage you to prayerfully seek the Lord. If you would like to be baptized and you haven't yet, reach out to me. I would be so privileged to participate in your baptism, however we can make that happen in a pandemic, okay? So if you haven't been baptized and you would like to be, reach out to me and we will make it happen. Now, if you have been baptized, you don't need me to remember your baptism. And so I want to encourage you this week to, when you come to God with that Thirsty 30, grab a little glass of water. And at some point in the midst of your time, maybe in your prayer time, maybe in your scripture reading, whenever, I want you just to dip your finger in that water and make the sign of the cross on your forehead and remember your baptism. Okay? Now, let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we give you thanks and praise for that moment that you saved us, for that moment that your saving grace entered into our lives and renewed us, made us new after your image through the power of Jesus Christ. We thank you for that, Lord. But Lord, we also thank you for the continual renewing of our hearts, our minds, our lives, reorienting us toward you. Lord, we pray that we would have a cooperative spirit, that we would partner with you in leaning ever more into you, that your lost image might be retraced in our lives once again as we remember our baptisms. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're reminded through the gracious gift of God, through the waters of baptism, that God has given us everything that we have. God entrusts it to us and calls upon us to be good stewards of his gracious gifts. Part of that is God's call to us to give generously. We are called to generosity not because God has need of our gift, but because God knows that we have need for practicing generosity. We invite you to continue supporting the ministries of this church, that that generosity of God might spill out from our lives into the lives of the people of this community and beyond. We are so grateful for your continued support. And if you'd like to support our ministries moving forward, you can do that in a couple of ways. You can send us your donation. We do, in fact, get the mail. You can log on to our website at BrightonUnitedMethodistChurch.com/donate and make your donation there. Or you can set it up with your financial institution to send us your contribution automatically. However you support the ministries of our church, we want to thank you and continue to encourage your generosity as we together reach this community and beyond for the kingdom of God. Now, if you find yourselves in need during this time of pandemic, maybe you've lost your job, maybe your hours have been cut, maybe you're just struggling for some other reason, we want you to reach out to us at our prayer email address at BrightonUMCprayers@gmail.com. Let us know of your need. Perhaps we, your church family, can help you. Don't allow shame or guilt or embarrassment prevent you from reaching out. Give us, the body of Christ, the opportunity to help you in your hour of need. And now, friends, may we give generously to the God who gives us everything. Thanks be to God.
I remember how it felt when I heard about the cross. I was thinking to myself, how could I be worth that greater cost? And the story was unfolding. I heard a voice like I had never known. That's when mercy called my name. That's when love broke every chain. And changing, and grace became amazing. I have walked so many miles. I'm no stranger to the rain. Takes me back to one day long ago. That's when mercy called my name. That's when love broke every chain. When his blood covered my sin, and my life began changing. Thank you.
come to a time of prayer where we invite you to lift up your joys and your concerns that are on your hearts and minds. We want to invite you to take advantage of our prayer email address by sending us your joys and concerns to BrightonUMCprayers@gmail.com. When you send in your prayer requests there, they come directly to me. When they do, I lift them up in prayer, and then I send them along to our prayer warriors that we might keep you in prayer throughout this week. And if you would like to join our prayer warrior team and help us in praying for your brothers and sisters, it's as easy as going to our website, scrolling down a little bit to the link where you can click to sign up on MailChimp to receive our prayer warrior email updates. However you lift up your prayer request, give us, your church family, the privilege of praying with you and praying for you. Together, we will contend for your breakthrough in the mighty name of Jesus. And now, we come together at the beginning of Lent to pray that God would give us strength and peace and faithfulness in this season of preparation. Let us join our hearts and minds together in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we come before you at the beginning of this journey of Lent. We pray that you would meet us afresh in this season. As we humble ourselves before you, Lord, we pray that you would renew our faith, that you would strengthen the bonds between brothers and sisters in Christ, that you would open up opportunities for fellowship, that you would strengthen and steel our resolve to seek after you, to hunger and thirst for your presence, to long to meet you in the pages of your word, to come to you in renewed lives of prayer. Lord, we come to you at the beginning of this season knowing that there is much in our world to distract us. There's illness and fear. There's panic, uncertainty, broken relationships, hardened hearts. Lord, we come to you with these burdens. We lay them before your throne, knowing that you are God, knowing that none of our problems are bigger than you, knowing that none of our obstacles are too much for your Holy Spirit. Lord, we pray that you would empower us to meet the needs we see around us, that you would heal our brokenness, that you would bring health and wholeness where there is sickness, that you would bring peace where there is fear, that you would respond to our prayers according to your perfect will. Lord, we entrust our joys and our concerns to your mighty hands, knowing that you are faithful. We give them over to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, the one who taught us how to live, the one who shows us how to love, and the one who brings us together in prayer as we now join in saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We hear in the message today of a call to remember our baptism. Today, we will join together as a congregation in remembering our baptism together. If you have not yet been baptized, I want to invite you to consider prayerfully that you might take that next step. Reach out to us here at the church and be baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. For all of us who have been baptized, we now join in remembering our baptism together. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's good gift, offered to us without price. Through the reaffirmation of our faith, we renew our covenant, declared at our baptism, acknowledge what God is doing for us, and affirm our commitment to Christ's holy church. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? I do. According to the grace given to you, will you remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world? I will. Let us join together in professing our faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testament, as we join in saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and of earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now, friends, we gather our hearts and minds to remember our baptism as we pray a thanksgiving over the water. Let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, You swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, You saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, You set in the clouds a rainbow. When You saw Your people as slaves in Egypt, You led them through freedom, through the sea. Their children You brought through the Jordan to the land which You promised. In the fullness of time, You sent Jesus, nurtured by the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by Your Holy Spirit. He called His disciples to share in the baptism of His death and resurrection, and to make disciples of all nations. Holy God, pour out Your Holy Spirit, and by this gift of water, call to our remembrance the grace declared to us in our baptism, for You have washed away our sins, and You clothe us with righteousness. Throughout our lives, the dying and rising with Christ, we may share in his final victory. And now, friends, we are called to remember our baptism. I invite you to touch the water with your hands, to make the sign of the cross on your forehead. Remember your baptism and be thankful. Amen. The Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen. And now, having remembered our baptism, I invite you to pray with me a prayer of thanksgiving. We give thanks for all that God has already given us as members of the body of Christ, and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we will faithfully participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. The God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. Amen. Remembering that Christ has redeemed you, go to share that redemption with the world. And as you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.